So the thing that's intrinsic for a hunk of uniform stuff is the material property that says how much the atoms inside that metal or whatever it is don't like to be stretched away from their equilibrium bond lengths. But how much the whole ensemble is going to stretch depends a lot on the geometry of it. So how many of them, how many of those bonds do we get to stretch in order to elongate the whole thing? So it's a little bit tricky. And you might ask, well, okay, so how good is Hooke's law, which says that the elongation is proportional to the force? Well, it works for a while, but if I were to yank on this spring enough, you'd probably guess it will get destroyed. It will get to a point where it doesn't return to its unstretched condition. You actually bend the metal and it retains the deformation. So if you become a mechanical engineer, you might get to play with a toy like this, which is a tensometer, to try to figure out the material properties of a specimen of something. Maybe it's a glass, maybe it's a metal. You can put it in this machine and it pulls the living daylights on that specimen that's going up and down there, and it measures how much it elongates as a function of the force applied. And so for a while, it's linear. Stress means the force per unit of the cross-sectional area. So it's got the same units actually as pressure. Force per unit area, that's stress. Strain is the proportional elongation. So how much has the length of the bar changed compared to its original length? What fraction? So strain has what units? None, because it's the new length, it's the change in length over the original length. So length over length, no units. That's strain. And you can see that it's proportional, at least for a while. And the linear region is described, that's what Hooke's law is telling you. And most materials will have that. Then all hell breaks loose. Go back. Or not. Yeah, so then it reaches a point where it starts to deform plastically. And that means that if you take the force off, it doesn't return to the original configuration. And you keep going, whoops, and then it eventually gets harder. And finally, at point three, what happens? It breaks, okay? So it does some strain hardening, and as you pull harder, it gets, you know, it's better able to handle, and what's going on inside is a big topic of interest on metallurgists to try to figure out how do you tailor the heat treatment, for instance, of metals in order to get the best kind of elastic properties, and then finally it will break. I think those of you who become engineers will get to play with toys like that. Okay, I want now to get on with F equals something or other. So we've said that the force is equal to the time rate of change of the momentum, but I want to read that equal sign. I think really, based on our understanding of springs, what that means is force causes. That equal sign means causes. Force causes a change in the momentum of an object. So the net force on the object changes the object's momentum. If the momentum is a constant, then the derivative really only cares about the velocity. And we call the time derivative of velocity the acceleration. So an equation that we're going to use a whole lot is F equals ma. That is, the force causes the acceleration and mass tells you the proportionality constant. So that would say, and we'll do an example, if you knew force as a function of time, then you could go backwards from here and integrate to get V and integrate again to get position, if you knew the force as a function of time. Sometimes we do, sometimes we don't. So we're going to start with that. So suppose that I had a force on a mass that is a constant. And this is the example that everybody has done in high school. So we have a uniform force, such as might be provided by gravity. Then, since the acceleration is the derivative of the velocity with respect to time, integration undoes the differentiation, so I can integrate over the same time interval, and I get the change in the velocity between time t and time zero is equal to the acceleration times the time, since the acceleration is a constant. The integral of dt is just t. That wasn't supposed to happen. I hit the laser button. Stupid thing. Okay. So continuing, I can integrate again. The velocity is just dx dt, and I have this expression where v sub x 0 is the velocity at time 0, and a sub x is a constant. So I can play the game again and integrate with respect to time. The integral of dx dt with respect to dt, that's just undoing. That's what the, what do you guys call that? Antiderivative or something? So that's just undoing the differentiation by taking the integral. And on the right-hand side, I just have this polynomial in time. So that integrates on the left, change in x, so x at time t minus x at time 0. On the right is vx naught t. And what is the value at 0? Well, I guess that's 0 because these two terms involve t. So at time 0, the contribution is 0. So if I now throw x naught over to the right-hand side, I get what is lovingly referred to as the kinematics equation for constant acceleration. How many of you have not seen this before? One. Okay. Now, what typically happens in a non-calculus-based physics course is that's the end of the story. And now you just memorize the kinematics equation and you use that. But we are better than that. We know how to differentiate and we know how to integrate. And don't tell me, yeah, or Wolfram Alpha does, okay? So we are going to practice, oh yeah, don't memorize this. If the time comes and you need to, you will integrate, okay? And we'll have practice for that in recitation and in homework, okay? So if you have the acceleration, it might not be a constant. It might be some function of time. How do you go backwards? You integrate to get velocity, integrate again to get position. And this formula here is only true if the acceleration is constant.